Good morning, May 25th. In this restive world, it's always a restive world. What we're trying to do here is point out where peace can be found. And so we will do that in this video. First, we settle in with the right focus, which is confidence we will succeed. Mood of repentance, meaning maybe a little resistance. Remain very calm, centered, full of confidence we will succeed. It's very important to have this feeling like we're going to get it. No question about it. Now, what is this restive world? It's all symbolic. What are dreams? They're all symbolic. Dreams are symbols, images, symbols. Imagination with symbols, images. This world is all symbolic. Bodies are all symbolic. That all stands for what? Reality, the self. But does reality need to be symbolized? Did God say, you know what? I don't understand reality. Can you symbolize it for me? No. Symbolizing reality is a way to disassociate from it. And we want to disassociate from reality because we want to create a separate creation from God, where our creations don't recognize their creator. So we are working on symbolizing something very different than reality. So our creations will not realize that reality created them. All right? So this world's a very restive, restless place, to say the least. But it's all symbolic. It's all symbolic. Now, I've said in the videos, zero times zero is the form of enlightenment, which is true. So what happens with symbols? We have all these symbols of form, time, space, form, bodies, actions, activities. In a dream, it's all like a spiritual dream. What happens to all those symbols? Well, what happens is, for example, let's say again, a dream is symbolized by zero. It has zero relevance to reality, actually. Reality doesn't need the dream to know what it is. So in order for reality to be what it is, nothing has to happen. It already is what it is. So a dream has no causative relevance whatsoever. It's a zero as far as causative relevance. As far as changing anything, zero relevance. It's a zero. Nothing happens in a dream to reality. Nothing whatsoever. So it's a zero. Now, what keeps a dream going is we are fascinated by trying to expand the dream. So we expand it by a power of like 1,000. So it's 1,000 times zero. We said we're going to expand it times a million times zero. And we're fascinated by all these expansions and contractions, these cycles. The dream is this restive cycling, isn't it? Expand and contract, cycle this way and that way. We're fascinated by these changes we think we're making to what? To zero. And we don't realize that none of these changes to zero have any effect whatsoever on zero. Because we're so caught up in the relativism of saying, well, I'm expanding it by a power of 1,000. And someone else says, I'm contracting it from 1,000 down to 950. And we say, wow, you know, you're contracting what I expanded. And they say, yeah, it's too much. And they say, wait a minute. It's all this intense, restless turmoil, right? Of expansion and contraction. And we're intrigued by our creative power to be able to interact this way on this level of a dream of symbols of expansion and contraction, where in reality zero is neither expanding nor contracting. It's not being changed in any way. There's nothing. It's zero. So nothing's happening actually in the dream, but we don't see that. However, there's nowhere to go for a dream except back to zero, to recognize that anything times zero is zero. So ultimately, the recognition, but because of a continuity problem, we don't want to drop the dream, form of the dream, all at once. So we've been expanding zero by all this, contracting, expanding, contracting. So we're used to using our creativity this way. So what we do is we continue. We say, oh, I'm going to expand zero by zero. I'm going to multiply, expand zero by zero. I'm going to contract zero by zero. So we're contracted. Zero is contracted by zero. Zero expanded by zero. So we still have this, we can still reference symbols, the dream, zero, contraction, expansion, except now it's by zero. And so there's no more intrigue about quantity, about numbers. Is it 1,000? Is it 2,000? Is it 1,000,000? What's the significance? What's the importance? What's the meaning of all this stuff? We don't get lost in a dream of relative meaning. Relative meaning is no meaning, actually. But this is what we need to awaken from this delusion. Okay, so we've got this principle. Now, going further. This is the only place where the dream has to go. The only where the dream has to go is back to recognizing that zero is zero. So all of us who are intrigued by this dream of relativity without realizing the other side of the equation, which is zero, we say, wow, we're only looking at one side of the equation. Is it, and overlooking, duality is to say, well, are we increasing, expanding zero by 1,000, or are we contracting it down a little bit? Overlooking the center, which is zero. What is it that we are expanding or contracting? How can we contract zero? How can we expand zero? So duality is to look at the relative cycling of expansion and contraction and to see relevance and importance and interest and intrigue in this, and to not see that what we believe we're expanding and contracting is zero. Zero relevance. Zero meaning. So expanding zero meaning or contracting zero meaning away from an expansion is equally meaningless, isn't it? We can't make no meaning less, and we can't make no meaning more. It simply is nothing. So duality is to get lost in this dream of relative meaning. Meaning relative to some other quantity. Quantities of expansion and contraction. Pressure. To get lost in that, in judging and evaluating all that, and not realize that it actually has no value, and therefore there's no need to judge any value, because it's all related to zero. Totally irrelevant. The Son of God cannot be separate from reality. So a dream of separation is totally meaningless. It's a zero. It has zero relevance to reality. So there's nowhere to go with this dream of duality. Of, is it a thousand expansion by 1,000, or is it expansion by 950? Which one is it? And we're looking at these two, 950, 1,000, 950, 1,000, 950, and we're caught up in this duality, not realizing that the 950 times zero is zero, and the 1,000 times zero is zero, and so it's all just zero. So we can just say, okay, let me times this by zero to keep referencing it. We don't see that. That's the shift that we need to take for the vision of oneness. Now, the vision of oneness is just everything in the dream times zero. Everything times zero. That's the vision of oneness. the shift away from relative duality, this was it 1,000 or 950, 1,000, 950, to realize in 950 times zero, 1,000 times zero, it's for both zero. That takes us into the be here now, realization, the vision of oneness. It's just a simple shift. So there's nowhere to go for this dream except to make that simple shift. Ah, the resolution of duality in as zero times zero. For the sake of continuity, we'll keep the expansion, contraction issue. We can multiply it. If you multiply it, you can divide it, right? If you multiply and divide, zero divided by zero, zero times zero, zero minus zero, you know, however you want to say it, but just zero times zero, it's still zero. But we still feel there's some creativity, some action there. It's for the sake of continuity. That's how the dream resolves for everyone. There is no other resolution to it. See, now the Holy Spirit, we think the Holy Spirit has a tough job. But the Holy Spirit knows this is how it resolves and knows that all these attempts to expand and contract are all zero. But it created specifically to work within the relativity of duality with a gentle, humorous way to gradually get us to recognize, oh, wait a minute, I'm referencing zero on both the poles of duality. I'm just still referencing zero. So the Holy Spirit is perfect at what his job, his mission, is to bring all spirit to this realization of zero times zero. It can't help but succeed because it's already zero. The dream is resting on zero. There is no other foundation for the dream. Never will be. So the Holy Spirit is able to bring all of us to this realization eventually. Eventually. Now there are those who are working on expansion and contraction to such an extent, they're so, you know, into it, that it may take them a while, that they see meaning in it and importance, and they do not yet realize that both are all just simply rests upon zero. So the Holy Spirit is perfectly patient, has total patience. And it's not difficult for the Holy Spirit to bring everyone to zero. It's not difficult at all. Piece of cake. Easy. For us, it seems very difficult. If we thought, how do we do it? Well, it's not our job. It's the Holy Spirit's job to bring everyone to zero. Our job is simply to accept the zero times zero as the form of enlightenment. Now, how do we do that if we accept? Is it our enlightenment? No, it's everyone's enlightenment. So, what we do is we accept the zero times zero for everything. Meaning we see everything as enlightened. That's the vision of oneness. The vision of oneness sees the enlightened form of everything. So we will see one another as zero times zero. When looking at bodies, for instance, we see zero times zero. The great saints, sages, and gurus have told us that when they look at a body, they don't see bodies. They see a light, beautiful, shimmering, glowing, golden light. There's no bodies there. They don't see bodies the way we see them. They're seeing zero times zero. They're seeing the form of enlightenment. The body of enlightenment is zero times zero. So what we do is we trust in the Holy Spirit and say, Holy Spirit, I trust that you will bring everybody in and I don't have to worry about that. So I can see everyone as they truly are, which means not symbolized except by the symbolization of non-symbolization, zero times zero. I can see everyone that way already. I don't need time. I don't need to wait on time to see everyone as healed. Everyone have it with a healed mind. I can see it right now because I know you're going to do it. It's, in fact, from the Holy Spirit's perspective, it's already been accomplished. In other words, the Holy Spirit can see the end from the beginning. And it's already accomplished this at the level of accomplishment. It's just a matter of getting everyone to see this fact. Accept this fact. So the healing has already taken place. It's just we haven't yet accepted it. So we can see this vision of oneness as seeing the Holy Spirit's job already completed. It's already completed like that. And we can literally have that vision of oneness right now and see everyone in this zero times zero, in this perfectly healed condition already, without any exception. We don't need to see these fantasies of symbolization that spirit is still using, which are our bodies, our activities, everything that's going on. These are just a fantasy, continued fantasy. We don't have to see the world that way. We don't have to wait on time and imagine the process and all of that. Trust that the Holy Spirit has completed its job and is simply now gently informing us, each one of us, that yes, I did my job perfectly, and everything related to zero, I've been able to see it all subside into zero times zero. Collapse time totally. The Holy Spirit is the great spiritual master of collapsing to all time, time and space, and it already has collapsed time and space in its mind. So it knows that time and space is totally collapsible, that everything we've done or tried to do in symbolization is completely collapsible into the zero times zero. And so we can use the Holy Spirit's mind, use the Holy Spirit's vision, which is really our own healed mind, our own healed vision, and see the world that way. We don't have to see all these suffering bodies and all these troubles and all of that. Because all of that, again, will subside into zero times zero. So if that's an absolute given, it will do this, then why do we have to wait in order to see what is absolutely assured and given? Why do we have to wait on that? Wait. Why do we need to wait and say, well, I don't want to see it yet? Why? It's like there's a treasure chest, and someone assures us that it's full of treasure. And we say, well, I want to wait. I don't want to open the lid. You know, maybe the treasure is still forming in there. Maybe it's not there yet. No, it's there. It's for sure it's there. Why do you wait to open the lid? Open the lid and see the treasure. So we do need to look at this and just realize we're waiting for no reason whatsoever. It's a stupid waiting. Recognizing our stupidity is very important. I've been trying to prepare for earthquakes here in California, and every morning I wake up and I realize that my preparation has been stupid. I haven't been preparing properly. Wow, so many holes. It's the most ridiculous. I say, wow, that's stupid. How come I didn't think of that? Well, it's the willingness to recognize your mistakes that is the spiritual path. Recognize, wow, that was stupid. And then you correct it, and you say, wow, I'm not nearly as stupid as I was yesterday. Now, it's not easy in this world to believe that everybody's going to get back to the zero times zero, because there's so many people who seem so arrogant and so like they don't have any stupidity, they don't make any mistakes. It's just some personalities and attitudes, you think, wow, I don't think they'll ever. in this duality, which gives rise to this sort of righteous judgment, arrogant mindset that can get very intense and severe, yes. And yet, all the while, the zero that's resting on this foundation is zero, all the while, and always will. So there's nowhere for them to go except back to the zero times zero. You know, and keeping this arrogance and judgment, and I don't do anything, I'm not making any mistakes or anything like that. I don't have to correct any mistakes, you know, project. All of that is so much suffering and misery that eventually they'll say, hey, there's got to be something better than this. And the Holy Spirit is always there. So it can be difficult to say, hey, I'm going to see everybody as healed. Because you think, well, there's one person or so who, you know, I don't think they are going to be healed. I think, well, it may take them a fairly long time. But probably not as long as we think. Because the Holy Spirit's a great saver of time. As far as how long it takes us, it can easily make the path much quicker than we think. But there is always going to be those who you feel, wow, they're lost, they're really lost. And you just read the internet, all the comments on all the various news articles, and which sometimes I do, and I just say, wow, I get more intelligence from a chattering group of monkeys than this, you know? I just say, good grief. But it's all due to this relativeness. They're arguing, you know, over this just ridiculous stuff. You know, is it 1,000 or is it 1,001? And they'll spend a lifetime screaming at each other. Have we expanded zero by 1,000 or 1,001? And they'll argue incessantly, calling each other names. And of course, if you realize, you know, that this rests upon zero, you just say, what? You know, what in the world? It's just time idly spent, is all it really is. And the Holy Spirit just helps us realize that spending time is time idly spent. And the continuity problem is resolved by zero times zero. Instead of dropping zero and times zero, multiplication or contraction, expansion, contraction, instead of dropping zero and expansion and contraction of zero, keep the zero and keep the concept of expansion and contraction, except expand and contract it by zero. That solves the continuity problem, doesn't it? Because you still feel that there's symbols and activity with symbols, but you're also allowing in the truth, right? So you're able to have this sort of intermediate step. So what the Holy Spirit tells us is that all this relativity duality is just time idly spent. Nothing's happening at all. Time idly spent. We don't need to focus on that. It's just completely idly spent. So if it is time idly spent, why do we need to even look at it and keep waiting? It's like a treasure chest full of treasure, and we're sitting there waiting. It's time idly spent. Open the treasure chest and view the treasure. Waiting, 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 waiting. You know, do we open it? You know, what time do we open this chest? Is it, you know, in an hour or 15 minutes? And we'll argue, and we can't resolve it. Say, well, we can't open it yet, we couldn't resolve it, so maybe a year from now or 2 years from now. And intense discussions, intense arguments. The treasure's there, just open the chest. Anytime at all. Anytime at all. Since it's already there, we need zero time to wait on it. Reality's already is. There's no need for any time to wait on it, to become. There's no reason, there's no becoming of reality. It already is what it is. It's always is what it is. That which is, it has always been, always will be, everywhereness, pure spaciousness. So we don't need to try and figure out when do we open the treasure chest. It's always right now. It's always there for us. It's not going to change if we wait. It's not going to be different if we wait. Whether we wait a minute or an hour, it's no different. It's not going to be any different. Whether we wait a trillion years, the treasure chest won't be any different. It won't change. Procession of motorcycles, but now they've gone and the rumbling has stopped. Very interesting that the collective grumbling, like it sounded like some great ball rolling towards you or something. Say, what is that? It was just this collective sound of all these motorcycles. Interesting. When we had the 89 earthquake here, I remember hearing this rumbling like that. It was like a freight train, huge freight train coming towards you. You said, what's that sound? What's that sound? Well, what happens is everything shaking. Everything shaking. Things falling over, shaking trees, shaking houses, the ground. All of that sound all adds together in the atmosphere and is transmitted, and you can hear it before the earthquake even hits you. You hear this rumbling in the distance, like, what is that rumbling? And you hear this roaring rumbling, and then the earthquake comes. I don't know if it comes, the sound comes first or the shaking comes first. I can't quite remember, but there is this enormous sound of roaring from it because of just all of the motion, that is reverberation of motion, that is going on with everything. There's nothing like it. There's no sound like it. Terrible sound. Just, you know, all the plates falling. It's just a collective sound from everything that vibrates all the air. All the air is being vibrated, and you just say, wow, what is that sound? Billions and billions and billions of little things all vibrating at the same time. All adds up to this vast sort of white noise background of the earthquake. Now, the restiveness of the earth the expansion and contraction of the earth, of everything in this dream. Constant cycling, everything brings disasters, brings problems constantly. All sorts of troubles, always. But do we have to see that? Or can we see it as zero times zero? Can we see the world as zero times zero? Absolutely. Can we see the universe as the form of the universe as zero times zero? Absolutely. See everything as zero times zero. See everywhere as zero times zero. Do not have to wait on time to realize that anything times zero is zero. So see, time is like saying, well, I've got 950 expansion by 950. I want to make it 1,000. Okay, so we gotta go 950, 951, 952, 953, 54, 55, 56, you know. And we think that expansion is happening, and we think, okay, that's time, we're expanding time. No, because 950 times 0 is 0, 951 times 0 is 0, 952 times 0 is 0, 53 times 0, 54, 955 times 0 is 0. There's no expansion of 0 happening. That's why they say nothing is ever happening. Nothing's ever happened. You hear the gurus say nothing has ever happened. Now these are very profound insights, so we go a little slow with this. This is not just some television talking heads jabbering away on TV. So see, this is one of the big problems. TV is just the worst thing ever, really. If you want to fail, if you want to keep on in duality, TV is a great way to help you do that. All right, so those who want to keep on duality, television is a great, great tool for them, for sure. But it's a terrible, terrible tool if you want to be realized, enlightened. Because constantly the airspace is filled with jabbering, 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 jabbering about nothing. And when we get into these really profound recognitions, we need to go slow. We need to have some quiet time. You know, we don't need to be talking every moment. Because we need to absorb this. It's like, wow. We absorb the wow of it. And if you're totally, we're totally accustomed in our socialization to jabber, 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 jabber. This keeps us bound to duality. Because duality is absolutely, infinitely full of considerations and judgments and like, wow. It's just, there's no end to it, is there? Like, okay, how do I relate 10 to 1,000? You know, how do I relate all these expansions and contractions and what's, you know, how do I relate all this? It's endless. Whereas in realization, none of that is there. It's zero times zero. So the wow factor has to, in our culture, we need a culture of enlightenment, which is, we could just sit quietly with one another and speak occasionally and not speak. We can sit there not speaking, and what we're sharing should be have a wow factor. So I think, well, I know the one of the reasons people love to smoke pot, there's so many young people smoking pot, is it gets them into this, like, not talking mode. They may talk, and then they just stop talking. And it's kind of a way of trying to self-medicate against the culture of the world. But there really is many, many very bad side effects that of course, people are denying. They say pot cures everything. It's like a miracle. No, a ton of side effects. Very bad, actually. All medications have side effects. Just talked to a doctor yesterday, and she said, you know, every single thing you take, there are side effects, okay? No way around it. So, what we need to do is to have these periods of time every day where we relate in a way that gives space for wow. It's like the music of the day. It is a very telling what's going on in the world. The entertainment, the news, the media, the television, all of this stuff is custom designed to enhance duality, enhance your participation in duality. For instance, the music of today. It is so full of all this tricks. So much going on there at so many levels. There's no place, no space in the music for wow. Now the older music, the music I actually really like, tempo is very slow, mostly slow, very relaxed, easy, relaxed tempo. The music instruments, very sparse, minimal. The singing, easily understandable. The whole thing full of spaciousness. So that there's room for the wow factor, room for you to put yourself into this music and say, wow. And relate to it. And say, I can just feel this because the music's not going too fast. I'm not being dictated to, I'm being invited. I'm being invited into this feeling. I'm being invited into it. And maybe the drum is just a soft snare, you know, just a real soft snare. And tempo is very smooth and slow, and just this wide, spacious feeling to it. Plenty, lots of room. So the listener is actually part of the experience, part of the music. Whereas these days, it's like something like an avalanche, you know, burying you, the music. It's like idolatrous, you know, music. The playing, this like piano playing, for instance, like slip key, is just a few notes here, a few notes there, just little accents, and then you, in your own feeling, is pointing to something, and it's giving you the good music. Just points, just pointers towards some feeling. It's not trying to give you the feeling. It's not forcing a feeling on you. It's just pointing, and here's the feeling. You provide the feeling. It's like that. So slip key piano playing, like Floyd Kramer. Minimalistic. All the instruments like are minimalistic. And the singing is also minimalistic. simple, clear, simple, minimalist, everything. It is evocative, and it's giving you, it's inviting you, and you're... There's no room for the listener anymore. You're being dictated to. It's the dictatorship is here. It's a dictatorship of entertainment. You know, the cultural dictatorship is already present, actually. And so people are so used to that that they're going to accept dictatorship for sure. In fact, it's roaring down upon us as an avalanche, dictatorship, executive order, executive order, there's so many executive orders already in the world. So many. All these agencies, alphabet soup of agencies, all have these executive orders that nobody even hardly knows about, that legally they feel that they can then act on all these executive orders, and, you know, total dictatorship, martial law, easy, all of this stuff. There's nothing standing in the way of it. People are not informed. You know, it's a dictatorship, and you can feel it with the music. I used to play the blues. Now, the blues can be very minimalistic. You just hit a note and hold it a little bit, drop it. And it's just evoking, like, this feeling. Yeah. Wow, this world is really rough, rough place. It's the tone, it's the feeling, it's the evoking. It's not just, you know, an avalanche on your head. So we are, the world is in this dictatorship right now, actually. Which is totally designed to avoid the wow of, hey, all this just relates to zero, which is enlightenment. It's a simple shift, as I've had it happen several times. And yet this culture, there's no room in the culture for it. There's no room in the culture for it. You cannot acculturate this anymore. I tried. I tried to bring back the music. I tried to change. I felt I could change the direction of music back to the simpler, sparser, evocative music. And failed at that. Failed. Terrible failure. I didn't realize the full scope of delusion. And how music is just an expression of the full scope of delusion. It's deeper than just musical expression. So you cannot just take a part of something and turn it around. It doesn't work that way. What works is enlightenment. Now, enlightenment does help enlighten a culture so that the music does become more sparse. But I was putting the cart in front of the horse. I was trying to change the music without being enlightened first. So first comes enlightenment, if you want to help others. Well, most people don't know where to go for help. See, but if you do know where to go for help, it's enlightenment. And then people will feel like, hey, this is what I really want. There's something, I know there now, there's something I really want. And so how do I adjust the culture, you know, to help me with this? But really, trying to adjust the culture too much is not a good thing. It sort of happens just as a byproduct, as a residue. I don't know, I don't think people should work on it directly. I don't know, I'll clarify this, but I certainly took the wrong approach in trying to change music back away from what it's become. I saw where music was going. I said, this is going to really cause a worldwide problem. Music's very important, actually, because it's evocative. People relate to it at a very basic level, right? You go into any store, there's music playing. Terrible music, terrible stuff. It's an atrocity. What music in this world now is an atrocity, actually. It leads to atrocities. I even like music that goes along and has just a stop to it. And then, dun, 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 it starts up again. I like this time to a stop, full stop. I like music to go from singing to actually speaking some of the music. So it's nice and slow speaking. Is a reflection. It just reflects. It reflects where we're at. So it's an indicator. So you don't really change where you're at by just trying to manipulate the indicators. You know, that you have to actually take the spiritual path. And then you can look at a culture and say, well, how is the spiritual path? How spiritual is a culture? By you can look at these indicators by the culture, the music, the dance, the music, the drugs, all these things. And if you see that there no one's using drugs. And the music is this very evocative, right? And the people are not into all this dancing and all of this physicality. And then you know that the culture is trending towards enlightenment, towards seeing the zero times zero, accepting zero times zero. And conversely, when you see the opposite, you realize it's trending toward dictatorship. The dictatorship of duality. The dictatorship of duality dictates that we only relate in a linear way. Okay. Is it 1,000 or 1,050 or is it 950? 950 here, 1,000 here, 1,050 here. Whereas the vertical way is to relate all of these numbers, these quantities of expansion and relative expansion and contraction. Related all to zero. See, that's the vertical, zero. Zero times zero is the vertical. Duality, dictatorship of duality, completely overlooks the zero. So the music will overlook the zero too, won't it? Their music. As a musician, the best way to play is to play something and then just stop. It might be a wow moment, like, wow, that was really cool. I was going to stop and just enjoy that. Wow. That's what we used to do. I mean, we just jam. We didn't play songs. We just play something really beautiful and then just, everyone, just the musician, just say, ah, that was really cool. Just kind of stop. Then noodle along a little bit and come up with something else like that. Yeah. Just stop. You sing something really great and it's just like, wow, and then you don't have to keep singing. Just stop. You don't have to complete the song. Not right away, you're not even have to at all. Because those are pointers. Those are pointers. They're pointers to the wow. Let everything subside as zero times zero. Because everything, every wow that we get in culture is really a faint echo of a zero times zero. Say, hey, I said, you know, the wow really is, hey, I wonder if I could just, it's all zero, zero times zero. I wonder if there's a subsidence in zero times zero. It's just a momentary, holy instant, a zero instant. It's like, wow, I just kind of, what was that? I got this wow. And we're not really sure what it is. It's this little momentary realization of, you know what? I think it's all reference to zero here. I don't need the linear, the vertical. And it may be faint and fuzzy, and there may be some linear still involved, but there's some vertical enters your awareness somehow. And that provides this wow. Now, when you watch modern entertainment, culture, media, movies, television, everything, music, news, discussions, there is no vertical, I'm telling you, from being born in the 50s, so almost 60 years here, I can tell the difference. There's no vertical now in this world. There used to be a little bit more than there is now, for sure. I'm not saying, you know, a huge more, but there's certainly more, no question more. no question there was more. Pace was slower. Everything, the pace was slower. At a time to just sit and just say, wow. I feel like there's something incredibly great, blissful somewhere. I'm not sure where. I just... Now, of course, youth is always, tends to be, have some qualities. Always. But that always fades, right? And the culture in general, you know, is what we're talking about. We're not just going to be fooled by the vigor of youth and the spiritual qualities of youth, of feeling they're not quite yet got the ego, you know, completely crystallized. But it's just a matter of, you know, working on it, and eventually it does crystallize. We're talking about the spiritual path, people taking time in their day, time right now. Walk into a store, people have time to greet you, say hi. But where I live, nobody has time to be friendly to one another. Everyone is too frantically chasing, you know, their next new great car, the next new great vacation car, you name it. I've never had a moment in where I live where, you know, you can talk to somebody and in the conversation you just say, wow, I like that, what you just said, and just sit there, just stand there and just say, that's really great. And just this wow, rarely, it's so rare that maybe it happened, I just say, my gosh, that hasn't happened in 10 years or 20 years. It's amazing, it's incredible, it's pathological. Because our day should be full of that, actually. Our interactions with people should be popping with wow. Now people try to fake it, but with drugs, you know, to like the, make their days meaningful. When the drug wears off, where are you then, you see? The worse the culture gets, the worse the drug problem will get. And that just makes the whole thing even worse. It's a negative spiral, as a matter of fact. Because people say, hey, I just don't have time to do this. I'm frantically trying to survive and get what I need, and so I'll just keep working like crazy, and I'll take drugs to give me a semblance of wow, you know, during, as I'm, you know, constantly working. Or I'll make the working so intense, it's like wow, I'm really succeeding so incredibly linearly, you know, a linear wow, like look what I did today, I did so much or something. You see, the sage, the saint, the guru, maybe they're just sitting there with a blanket. They're sitting on the ground with a blanket doing nothing. Except they're radiating, you know, this something like zero times zero. They're seeing the healed perception, the healed dream. They know all has been healed. And this fantasy is just playing out, but it doesn't matter. It's all already healed. They don't need to go anywhere. They don't need to do anything. It's a perpetual wow. They're just like this complete wow. It's just there. And so you feel that and you say, hey, this is great. And then you want to stay there, and then you start thinking, wait, I gotta go back to my life. I got mortgage, I got car payments, got payments of every kind of bills, career, how am I, you know, it's just like, wow. But nevertheless, those who want to awaken, accept the form of enlightenment, zero times zero, somehow their lives work out so they can do that. Somehow my life's working out so I've been able to do this. I It's evident that though this path is coming to an end, as that's evident for sure. So I'm expecting zero times zero. So if we're not feeling something profound during the day, like a profound realization is dawning, we're wasting the day. There is a profound realization within us to dawn. If you haven't had this clarified by the Holy Spirit, you would view this everything resolving to zero, zero times zero, duality, seeing the resolution of duality, you would see it as like a complete earthquake, catastrophe. You know, you'd feel like everything's about to collapse. Linearness is about to collapse. And you'd see it as chaos. You know, that's the problem. So, since everything already rests on zero, how do people defend against this fear? They project it outwards as earthquakes, as catastrophes, so they can see it out there. They can misplace the cause of it. You see, continuity fear is so severe that they'd rather project it as catastrophes, external catastrophes. So it is possible for there to be worlds, places, dwelling places that don't have any catastrophes. Everything's fine because there's no fear of the subsidence of all this linear duality into the vertical zero. There's no fear of that. And so there's no need to project this event as a catastrophic, dangerous, frightening event. There's no displacement of it as a frightening event. What I'm concerned about, as this culture becomes more dualistic, you're going to generate more and more severe problems. You're going to generate more and more severe earthquakes, severe tsunamis, severe plagues. All of this is being generated as a displacement out of the fear, inner fear, that of linear time, of all this linear duality collapsing. You see, that is already collapsed, as it were. It's already resting upon zero. But we're trying to keep it all up in the air. So we always feel like, wow, this could all fall apart. The meaning could be lost. But there is no meaning to it. How do you lose no meaning? It's already no meaning. It's already zero. But we keep imagining that we're kicking the can down the road. So definitely, as the culture gets more and more, the mindset here gets more and more dualistic, which is what's happening. And of course, people think that they're progressing. They're getting rid of the vertical. They think they're getting rid of their fear. They think they're getting rid of their fear by being more and more focused on the expansion and contraction of relativism, of duality. I'm expanding it by 500,000. See, now I'm expanding it by 1,000,000, and now I'm contracting a little back to 500,000 again. And they're so into that, they think that's protecting them from the collapse, you see. It's not really a collapse, it's a total gentle subsidence, because you're still expanding it by zero and contracting it by zero, zero by zero, just zero by zero. It's a gentle realization of this is what I really want. There's not a collapse at all. But they see it as a collapse. And so they project the collapse externally, and they actually want a economic collapse, a culture, a physical collapse. You know, all this collapse and catastrophes are projected as events, external events, somehow external to the mind. We have no control over it, so to speak, because this subsidence into zero, we do have control, because it's our mind, it's our choice. And we don't want that to happen. People are afraid of that. So when you leave the spiritual path, disasters do come. The weather gets worse. The severity of weather gets worse. Severity of earthquakes, all this stuff, which is why it's said in scriptures that there will be this very materialistic culture coming into the world, these mindsets coming into this planet at the end of the cycle. And when that happens, that will then be accompanied by all these disasters. So we're at that time, and this has already happened. Materialistic mindsets, the linear mindsets, inherently bring with them these projected disasters and catastrophes as an expression of their fear, as a displacement of their fear, projected displacement of their fear of the inner disaster, which they're afraid that the linear will be all resolved into the zero, which it already, of course, is resting upon zero. So we're at these times, which is why I'm concerned about disasters in the world, and they've been happening. They've been happening, actually. What was it, 2004, the tsunami, and then the one, what was it, 2000, Japanese, was it 2010, the Fukushima disaster, and many earthquakes, many disasters, the climate, the flooding, all this stuff. That's actually the expression of our own fear, of our own projected displaced fear, of this inner subsidence into zero times zero. But what I'm doing is trying to help avoid these disasters and stuff by spiritual work, because that's what actually works, is to lose your fear, evaporate the fear by understanding there's a continuity problem, there's a resolution, there's an intermediate step, which is zero times zero, zero by zero, either contracted, expanded, divided, multiplied, added, subtracted, zero by zero. That keeps reference with the dream. We reference the dream, we don't relate to it, but we reference it. Then there's no need to project any fear. There's no fear of letting duality subside into zero by zero. So there's no fear to be projected externally as external events to symbolize this fear, to make it seem something external to us, so we're not so frightened by it. You see, there's something, so at least we can do something of this, work on it linearly, you see. This is what I've been trying to do here in this world. Try to mitigate the disasters and catastrophes by spiritual enlightenment, spiritual truth. And at the same time, realizing pragmatically that there's so much projection around, there's likely it's going to happen. And so that's why I am preparing. I don't like to prepare because it seems like defeat, you know, but from a practical standpoint. Now hopefully the catastrophes won't be as severe, because all the spiritual work that's happening on the planet is actually lessening the intensity of these catastrophes. But drugs do not do it. See, this is the scourge of drugs. Drugs do not do it, because drugs do not provide this kind of clarity that's here. The calm peace, the calm love, the calm assurance, they do not. They're just trying to simulate a wow feeling, like an artificial wow. It's an artificial wow. It's not a wow coming from clarity. True wows come from clarity, like a wow of peace comes from actually seeing the truth of this in a calm way and abiding in the scene. So the problem with this linearity that's happening in this world, this materialism, has led to this extreme drug addiction of the planet, which has subverted the spirituality of the planet, because all these young people are not really disciplining themselves to a spiritual path. Spiritual path is a lot of discipline and will involved. You don't have that when you're on drugs. You say, I don't need that. I can just light up a joint. That's that easy. It's not that easy. And so you have a whole generations now. Generations, how many? Three generations who are more and more turning to drugs, more and more turning to drugs, as well as pharmaceuticals, medications, pharmaceuticals, all this stuff actually detracts from spiritual culture. Even though people think, no, I feel very spiritual when I'm high. I feel like a wow. It's an artificial wow. It's a sensory, it's playing with the sensory situation. It's an artificial wow. Real wow comes from seeing the basis of your freedom in relation to the Holy Spirit in a clear, alert, clear, focused, repentant, humble way. That takes discipline. That's why, like the Dalai Lama says, no, drugs are poison. They're poison of the spiritual path, for sure. And the spiritual path is what provides the culture. It's what provides a measure of protection from the various catastrophes. Now, of course it's complicated, because people could say, well, the Tibetans, they lost their country and all this stuff. If they're so spiritual, why did that happen? Well, there was a lot of also dark spirituality there, or the dark path of manipulating things taking place, and has taken place in Tibet too. It's a mixed bag there. We could also say that it forced the Tibetan culture out into the greater world, you see, which is to some extent been a helpful thing, trying to cultivate spirituality, spiritual path throughout the planet, you see. You could say the same thing about the Jews, the diaspora, the Jews. It forced the Jews throughout the whole planet. And the Jews tend to be very disciplined as far as spiritual path, you see. And that could have brought, that may have brought some spiritual discipline to the world. So there's various groups that may be dispersed throughout the world for that actually helps the spirituality of the world. And so the Tibetans may have, out of compassion for the world, actually allowed this to happen as an excuse, so to speak, to now have to go. There's Tibetan, you know, communities all over the planet now where that wouldn't have happened. And they tend to be very disciplined towards the spiritual path. I'm not giving a blanket endorsement to the Jews or Tibetans or anything like this. I'm just saying that there is a dynamic at work. It's a little, you know, so don't just say, there's nothing to that or something. No, there is something to it. But the drugs are a scourge, okay? They really are a modern scourge. And this was said in the Bible, that the end times will be a pharmaceutical planet. This planet will turn into a pharmaceutical, drugged out place. Certain sign of this very severe materialistic linear perspective of relativity, of duality. And people desperately trying to escape it through drugs, but you see, artificial wow, because the people feel that the materiality is so intense they don't feel they're able to deal with it. Now, I went through this whole situation myself. I know exactly what it's about. I went through it myself. So I'm speaking from absolute clear experience. It is true, the materialistic nature of this place is so extreme that I fully recognize why people would take drugs. However, the Holy Spirit is great enough to deal with the situation. It only takes discipline. It only takes determination, which we have within. Again, the Holy Spirit told me, why are you not doing this? What's the reason? Is it too difficult? You're not smart enough? Or are you lazy? And I said, it's laziness for sure. Yeah, you're right. So those who are taking drugs, self-medicating, to deal with this extreme, linear, dualistic situation in the world now, it has to be said, they're being lazy. There's no way of escaping that. It's laziness. Everyone has within them the capacity to relate to the Holy Spirit, to truth, to clarity. They can begin the path one step at a time. Everyone. So there's no way to escape the label of laziness if that's what the path someone is taking. And so for me, I said, wow, I'm not going to look back on my life and say I was lazy. That's all I did was just, I wasted my time, did nothing, and I was simply decided to be lazy. So I could not look at myself. I could not accept that. So I said, okay, let's get working here. Let's get working. So the first thing is tell yourself, don't be lazy. I cannot be lazy. I cannot be lazy in my relating to the Holy Spirit, in relating to truth, in relating to clarity, wherever you happen to see it, within you and without you, so to speak. Whether they're various teachers, various books, various teachings, or within, contemplation, meditation, listening to the Holy Spirit, clarifying. Cannot be lazy at that. And yeah, it's really a bummer that we're in this world where it's so difficult right now, for sure. But when the going gets tough, the tough get going. So you got to be tough. Have to be very tough. Very tough, very determined, bounce back. Of course you're gonna get smacked down over and over and over again. You just keep getting up. Keep bouncing back. That keeps wanting to solve its problems in a linear fashion. That's impossible. That just makes it worse. Just makes it worse. Because that'll only make a greater fear of the zero that it rests upon. Which means a greater projection of fear of catastrophe, of collapse. Which means projecting that in the future, which means the future is even more catastrophic. It just gets worse. Eventually, they have the fear of the whole galaxy collapsing, the solar system, galaxy, universe. You know, it just gets worse and worse and worse. So if you don't want to make it worse, it's absolutely necessary to embark upon the spiritual path. Step by step, to drop the laziness. Now, for some, maybe they'll say it's too difficult. Well, it's never too difficult. You can never allow that into because you're then cutting yourself off from the Holy Spirit. It's never too difficult for the Holy Spirit. No matter what situation arises, it's never too difficult for the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit experiences 0 degree of difficulty in helping anyone. A zero. No difficulty. So you can never say it's too difficult. Never say it's too difficult. Difficult, yes, for you, but not too difficult, because it's not difficult for the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is within you. Always. So it will always have some way to try to ease the difficulty for you, help you out. Even though it may, for you, the path seems extremely difficult. But it's never too difficult. it is possible to mitigate some of the intensity of catastrophes and troubles by having those who are enlightened in the world. That is certainly, certainly possible. You cannot get rid of all of it, because everyone has their free will, but it's certainly possible to be influential at a certain level, where sort of like a breeze is in the world, and people sort of feel this breeze. It's a subtle breeze, but at some moment they might feel it. It's like a subtle spiritual breeze, and they'll say, hey, wait a minute, what's that? That's nice. And then they may, for an instant, connect it with the zero, and say, hey, this zero, oh, that's wonderful. And they snap back into linear. But then they say, hey, wait a minute. Maybe this whole, I don't need to keep the intensity with this linear thing so going so severely. I can kind of lessen the intensity of a little bit. Now, of course, high technology has intensified it to almost a quantum level. It's intensified the linear intensity of the whole situation of duality. Because they say, hey, look, we can get even more intrigued with quantity, linear expansion, contraction, because we can crunch numbers like unbelievable. And people just say, wow, that's how I can get rid of my fear. Now it makes the fear worse, makes it worse. But this, there can be a breeze, a subtle breeze, a spiritual breeze. People can feel that is definitely true, definitely true. Those who want intense linear duality and therefore have no recourse but to project the inner fear externally as problems, as catastrophes, troubles, that intensity, that desire may actually cause them to manifest another world, or they may seem to just fade away from this world. Those who do not want this are not afraid of the zero times zero. They stay in this safe condition, calm, safe system. And those who want the linear duality may find themselves in a catastrophic world. There may be this subtle parting of the ways somehow. That's possible. It may come to that. But at least I've been able to lay out the big picture of let the details work out. What we're doing here is laying out the big picture of why catastrophe happens. Where does it come from? What's the remedy? Pretty interested in what happens next, for sure, always am, but it's really like they're doubling down. High tech enables the world, it tempts the world to double down on deception, on duality, double down on duality. And duality comes very heavy hit, and the fear then gets projected externally very, very badly. The projection can involve the sun. I mean, all of this stuff is dream anyway. I mean, so our projections of fear external are powerful. It can have all sorts of effects. extreme effects, actually. So I'm like saying, wow, you know, looking at all this various stuff that could be happening and is almost happening, and trying to smooth out the fear so it doesn't happen. But most certainly, we don't realize the intensity of our fear and the desire to project it externally and disassociate it from the linear, the zero, the foundation of zero upon which all symbols rest upon, is so intense. The continuity fear is so intense that the projection is so intense, we don't realize what it can do. We underestimate it. It can affect the sun, the solar system, the universe, the planet, everything in monumental, powerful ways, consequential ways. So we think, oh, the sun is so very stable. Not necessarily. Not necessarily. The sun responds to our thoughts. The world, the universe, everything responds to our thoughts. But it's all our dream. It's our dream. It's a spiritual dream. And so when we do this projecting and disassociation and displace the fear, that's going to show up there. The best way to help the world is to reside in zero times zero, zero by zero. And then this reassurance is a cool breeze throughout the world. And you really don't have to do anything. Actually, the most helpful would be somebody simply sitting in a cave somewhere in enlightened condition. And don't necessarily have to go anywhere. But the fact that they would be here referencing the dream is very important. To let people know we don't have to drop the dream all referencing entirely. We drop relating to it, but not referencing to it. See, that helps solve the continuity problem. So it's the ones that actually show up in this world referencing it that are important.
Did you get back repeating?
That relieves the continuity fear. People say, oh, good, I can still reference this. I can still reference this, you know, this body, these shapes, these forms, this world, this dream. I can still reference it. I don't have to relate to it anymore. I don't have to relate to the linear. I relate to zero by zero. But I'm still referencing a symbol, zero, and an action with symbols, which is multiplications, multiple expansion, contraction, and an action by another agent, which is also zero. So I'm still able to reference the basic parameters of the dream, you see. That's what's all important. Otherwise, we'll be too frightened. Too frightened. That's why people, you know, are so pleased by Jesus, because the zero times zero, the form of zero times zero, zero by zero, showed up in the world, referencing it, and saying, look, see, you can reference it. So it's a huge relief, inner relief to people. But there have been others also that have showed up zero by zero. And then that confuses people, not understanding the form of enlightenment is zero by zero. If you concretize the zero by zero too much, then you end up saying, no, this has to be the only one, or else it causes my fear to return. So that's a big problem, huge problem. I've been working on that problem my whole life, trying to help people with this. It's not enough for the form of enlightenment to show up zero by zero as a body and referencing the world. We have to relate to what it really is, which is zero by zero. When we relate that it's zero by zero, that enlightenment has a form. then we don't get trapped into this concretizing the person, the body itself, the personality, the body, the referencing, concretizing it. Because if we do that, then we no longer see it as zero by zero. And then we see that this unique, special form, not zero by zero, but something else, and therefore we think that our safety comes from this special form, and then any other form, perceptually, seems to diminish this other form, and then we get into this religious wars and all this stuff. And there definitely have been religious wars, there's no question about it, that there's been a tremendous fighting and animosity throughout history due to the over-concretization and reification of these zero by zero appearances of zero by zero. But if you realize it's simply the zero by zero referencing the dream, and the appearance of the body is not the point at all, how it actually looks or what it says or does. No, it is the fact that the peace, the zero by zero-ness, referencing the dream, is what solves the continuity problem. Then, if you see it that way, you're not bothered at all by that there are many appearances of zero by zero. Because it's all still the same, isn't it? Zero by zero. So I don't feel the slightest conflict between the various teachers. It doesn't bother me in the slightest bit. Because how could zero by zero have any special form or non-special form? You see, it's zero, zero by zero. We can all realize zero by zero. In fact, we all will. You see, if you don't see it as zero by zero, you'll take it linearly. If you take these appearances of zero by zero as a linear instead of vertical, as dualistic instead of non-dual, then you think that there is some dualistic relative rightness, and that you've got it now. And that anyone else in a linear way, what they say for sure is wrong and needs to be defeated in order for you to feel no fear. See, that's what leads to the trouble. All appearances of the great saviors, sages, saints, saviors, are appearances of the zero by zero, of the everywhere nowness, total non-specialness, total non-dual. So a zero by zero, we're all saviors of the world. Everyone's a perfect savior of the world, actually. Everywhere is a perfect savior of everywhere, of the universe. Everywhereness is all, everywhere there is the perfect salvation of the universe, is everywhere, actually. Everyone is the perfect savior of the universe. Everywhere is the perfect savior of the universe. Acknowledge that, and then you're walking in paradise, because wherever you go, you're seeing perfect savior. The perfect savior is everywhere. What we want, because of the continuity fear, is we want to feel we can still reference shapes, forms, still reference them. So that's fine. We have to understand the continuity fear for what it is, and then we will drop all this spiritual, this religious wars, all this stuff. See, it is possible to have religions and religious spiritual paths without all this warfare and conflict. In fact, the materialists are making it worse. I read all these news stories with discussions, and there's always a battle between religious people and atheists there, always. The atheists are making it worse, actually. because they're making it more dualistic, more linear. That gives rise to more and more concretization, reification of the abstract zero by zero, which gives rise to more conflict. So the religious conflict that they're condemning, they're the ones that are actually bringing it about by severe linear dualistic thinking. They're causing the very problem that they're criticizing. I mean, they're pointing out, yeah, there's all this religious spiritual conflict, but why? Because of secular, materialistic, linear, dualistic, relative spiritual pride is what's causing it. Because insistence that we put any appearance into this linear and dualistic context, then inevitably will lead to conflict, for sure. They just say, well, no, it's religion that's causing conflict. No, because secular human materialism has actually had even much, much more intense, worse conflict. Like in the 20th century, most of those battles have been secular, materialistic, humanistic, dualistic battles, right? And it's way worse. If you want to get better, you need to have a more spiritual, more religious focus on the vertical. And then people will start being more forgiving, more tolerant towards other appearances of zero by zero, other reassurances. And they'll say, great, I'm so happy. The more the merrier, the more the better. I like it. And then eventually you realize that everyone is the savior of the universe. Everywhere is the savior of the universe. And then you walking among saviors. Everywhere you go, everywhere, everyone, everything is the savior of the universe. It's all zero by zero. The savior from the dream. Everything is the savior from the dream. That's really enlightenment. It's not that you're enlightened, it's that you're able to see that everyone is a savior of the dream. They may not realize it yet, this fact of everyone, but this is already a fact. So atheists are very good at pointing out the problems of religion, describing them, you know, the symptoms, but they don't have a clue as how to solve it. Their solution actually is going to make it way worse, way worse. What is needed is those who see that everything is the savior of the universe, savior from the dream. The entirety, everywhere in the dream, is the savior of the dream, is the savior from the dream. So obviously I'm able to at least get a sense and feel for this. It's still, you know, a little fuzzy. But it's emerging. I'm getting away from this idea of individual enlightenment and realizing enlightenment is really your seeing. Ultimately, everyone, everywhere right nowness. The one body, one savior, one body, which is everywhere and everyone. That is the one body of salvation. There's nothing excluded from it. All forms, all places, all rest upon zero and can be seen as such. Zero by zero can be seen as the zero by zero. So there is this battle between religion and atheism on the planet. It is a most intense battle, severe battle here, actually. The secular materialists, the linear dualists, who think that kicking the can down the road is the answer. No, it actually gets into worse and worse catastrophes as you do that. They're battling against the religious concretized people who have concretized it and therefore feel very threatened by the atheists. I don't feel threatened by atheism. I don't feel threatened by it. It's laughable. You know, it's silly, laughable stuff. But religious people certainly feel threatened by it, those who are concretized. Because for me, I can say, I feel like, you know, I'm going to see that everywhere, everything, everywhere, it's all Savior. The Savior is everywhere. There's nowhere where the Savior is not, where salvation is not. This is the salvation of the universe. So I don't feel threatened by the atheists. You know, it's good for a few laughs and that's about it. But certainly the religious people who've concretized a particular zero by zero referencing feel that that's going to be taken away from them, and then they'll be plunged into zero, which scares them. So the fear of zero is still there. You see, it's still there within them. It's within all of us. I still have some too, so it's within all of us. And they feel, you know, like they're being pressured too strongly, and so they're willing to fight, you know, willing to fight and conflict and with atheism. So it's sort of duality fighting duality, you know, which is what happens. And we were making progress here in this world, actually, until the high-tech people came in with their materialistic mindset. They were now spreading atheism. We were making progress. And now it's all been deflected away, dispersed away, into racial issues, gender issues. All these issues are actually distractions away from the real issue. The red herrings being dragged across the road to get us off the scent. You know, we're like these dogs that are tracking the scent of truth. And someone drags this red herring, which has this terrible stench, smell, super strong smell, across the road. The dog gets to the herring, and its senses are so, you know, it's blasted by the smell of the red herring. It can't smell the scent along the road anymore. That's called dragging a red herring across the road. This this is what's happening, is all these other issues, these social issues, cultural issues, are really an attempt to distract our focus off of the real scent of salvation. That's why I just dismissed these topics as this not even worth talking about. These are all distractions. And you have these experts in red herring distracting us, getting us off the scent. The celebrities, the all the people, you know, who are out there in front of you saying, this is what's important. So spreading the scent of salvation, even at a subtle level, is very helpful. because at some moment someone may just suddenly smell the scent again, say, wow, I need to get back on the scent. The red herring effect wears off a little bit. Right now we're really severely, you know, hit by the red herring distraction of endless distractions and arguments about irrelevancies, really, of what has no real capacity to save us from this dream of separation, to help awaken us from this dream. So let us pray that the scent of salvation flows through the world like a soft breeze, and that we can feel and smell the scent and feel the soft breeze, the scented soft breeze of salvation, that it become aware of it more and more and more and more and more. Okay. That's enough for right now. Thanks for watching. I know these are long videos, but this is the path of spending some time gradually just kind of looking at it, because what we're seeing is just monumentally important. It's just, oh my gosh. You know, these are like huge key blocks we're looking at. Just seeing it, oh my gosh. So of course it's going to take a little time. Give ourselves, be patient with ourselves. Don't demand instant gratification. Oh, I got to get it right now or I'm no good. That's the ego. The ego says you got to get it right now or you're not suitable. Nonsense. We've got a vast, severely terrible continuity problem. So of course it's going to take time. Of course we're going to be hesitant. That's absolutely par for the course. And shooting par is great. I've never shot par in a round. You know, it's a goal, but you know, it hasn't happened yet. So anytime you're shooting par or above par, that's good. Just try to, you know, stay consistent and spend your time, give yourself time, plenty of time for this. Wow, I see this. Wow, that's great. I'm getting closer. Wow, I'm almost free. Wow, like that. It is when you realize you're almost free. It's like, wow, I realize I'm almost there, seeing everything everywhere as salvation from the dream. Everything everywhere as salvation from the dream. Almost there. That's a big wow. So I just have to let that percolate a little bit. Okay. Very great. That's it for this one.